In this special edition of Your Property Empire, we follow Chris and his team through one of his renovation projects to see how their combined skills and experience influence their decisions while keeping their clients' requirements and goals front of mind.
In our purchase or pass segment, we featured this two-bedroom unit as a renovator's delight. It's been converted into a three-bedder and it's in a block of nine units about a kilometre from Australia's famous Bondi Beach. Over the next 30 minutes, we're going to show you how we completely gut it and build it back up. Hopefully, we'll be turning it from an ugly duckling into a white swan. So welcome to our renovator's delight in Bondi. So we've got a two-bedroom unit here, and as you can see over here, there's a bit of a makeshift third bedroom. It's a pretty good use of the space. It's a very large lounge dining area here, so I'd say it's much better to have this third bedroom than an oversized lounge. So what we're thinking of doing is moving this wall in so it lines up with the doorway there to make the most of the hall space, and then actually pulling the door in here so it lines up with the window, so then we've got as much space as possible around here. I think it's going to be a fantastic room. We'll actually have the main entrance coming through here, so we're going to bring this wall out quite a bit. Because we've taken up a large part of the lounge with the third bedroom, it's really important to make this space work as well as possible. So what we're thinking of doing is cutting this wall out between the kitchen and the dining room and really opening it up. So either we'll have a breakfast bar in between the two, or we'll just leave it nice and open so it's free to have dining tables and kitchen tables and whatever else. We're lucky we've got a really big kitchen here. So even if we take out most of this wall, there's still plenty of space for all the appliances, the dishwasher, the washer dryer, and the laundry area behind you as well. In every renovator's delight, there's always a gorgeous bathroom that comes with it. There's cracked tiles, a leaking tap, and I just wouldn't fancy washing in that every day. One of the most appealing things about buying this apartment was it had very large double bedrooms, and certainly there's a lot of space here. There's certainly some great built-in wardrobes here, and even better, there's an ensuite bathroom as well. Certainly needs some love and care, but that's a real bonus when you're buying these investment properties. One of the most important things with bathrooms is to make sure that they're waterproof properly. So what we're going to do is strip literally every single thing out of this bathroom, waterproof from basically the floor right through to the ceiling, so it's all completely sealed, and then start putting things back together. Even though this property is supposed to be completely empty, you can see that either the tenants or the previous owners have left some of their prized possessions in there. And that's why when you're undertaking a renovation, it's really important to have some contingency in your budget, because you might need to have to pay to dispose of some of these things. As you can see, there's plenty of mess outside this unit, and the chances are it's probably our owners or tenants that have left it there. Now, it's not necessarily our responsibility, but we'll probably try and put a call into council or maybe actually dispose of it ourselves. The whole idea is to try and keep the neighbourhood happy, so when we're doing our renovation, they don't come and cause some problems.
Working with Chris is full-time professional buyer's agent, Josh Masters. After helping clients with their investment strategy, Josh searches for the right property and then negotiates the best possible price. Buyer's agents often get to access properties before they hit the open market.
What was the client's property investing strategy that made you choose this particular unit?
Chris, the strategy for this client really came down to a few things. First of all, he wanted to buy blue chip, which meant buying the best property he could in the best location he could afford. He also wanted to buy in the long term, which meant holding it for many, many years to get that strong, consistent capital growth. And he was also looking for something that he could add equity to, which meant buying an established property with renovation potential.
Why did you choose Bondi Beach in this particular street?
Bondi is probably one of the most iconic beach suburbs in the world. Strong, consistent demand over time. The young people around here, they have good disposable incomes, good jobs, they can afford to pay good quality rents. And we're only a few blocks back from the beach, so you can have a nice private lifestyle here, but only be a few minutes away from the bars and cafes.
There's a lot of units around Bondi Beach. What made you choose this particular one?
Well, this is a great big two-bedroom unit. It's probably close to 100 square metres, which is a great size for Bondi. It comes with parking in a boutique block, two bathrooms, great lifestyle, as I mentioned, close to the beach. It's very hard to pass up this kind of a property.
How hard is it to find units that meet our criteria?
Oh, listen, it can be very hard, as you know, probably out in the market. As much as we are, we see a lot of average investors looking at properties that are in large blocks, they're on main roads, they lack the privacy. Getting a boutique block like this that ticks all the boxes is really finding that diamond in the rough. And it really comes down to being in the right place at the right time. That for us means being out in the market every day, talking to agents, establishing relationships with them. And we've really been doing that year on year, which puts us in a great seat for finding sales that come onto the market in the first couple of days or even prior to that and getting them in a silent sale and buying them off market.
And how did you decide how much we should spend on the renovation?
We paid about $705,000 for this two-bedroom unit. We'll probably spend about $100,000 as a renovation. Now, a lot of people come in here and do a spruce up of carpet and paint. We actually find it's much more beneficial to do a top to bottom renovation. Really be consistent the whole way through. It really adds some value for the owner because of a few things. First of all, we get much better quality tenants in here. They look to stay for a much longer period of time. We can achieve a much better rent, which means obviously much better long-term returns over that period as well.
What's the financial difference between doing it yourself and using a professional buyer's agent?
Chris, the key to using a buyer's agent is having that third party in the transaction. Our decisions are based on financial rather than emotional. People can get caught up in the emotional decision, spend X amount at auction or within the buying process, and really lose that advantage in the pricing. Getting that extra 1% in the purchase price in the performance of that investment over time can mean an extra $5,000 to $10,000 in your pocket year on year for the rest of the time that you own that investment.
Whenever you're doing a renovation, it's important not to over or even undercapitalise. Spending $100,000, how do you know you're doing the right thing?
Well, that's a really interesting question. We actually look at a renovation as a separate investment to the actual unit itself. In this case, we're outlaying about $100,000 in the renovation fee, which equates to about $7,000 in interest on year. Now, for that return, we're actually getting about $250 a week extra in rent, which equates to around $10,000 a year. So that shortfall of $3,000 is actually a bonus for us in our pocket over and above the initial investment.
Well, we're a couple of weeks into the renovation now. There's been some dramatic changes, so I thought I'd give you a bit of a tour and show you around. So one of the biggest changes around here is obviously we've changed these old bookshelf walls to something brand spanking new. So it actually looks like a proper third bedroom now. To try and save a bit of space, we've moved the doorway, and then we're going to have an internal sliding door here, so we're not wasting too much room with a door coming in and out. Another great change in this unit over the last few weeks is taking out this wall between the kitchen and the lounge. So you can see with the beam above that we would have had to get an engineer in to describe exactly what kind of beam we need to support the floors above. And that's really important with a strata because they want confidence that you've done the right kind of job and the building's not going to fall down. So the plan is here is to maybe have some stalls this side, a breakfast bar here, and then it's nice and open for the dining room and obviously the lounge. We've now completely gutted the bathroom, which is a major change. Now, rather than putting tiles on tiles and having potential water issues down the line, we've decided to go back to bare walls and actually do it properly. The waterproofing line's really, really high, so no matter what happens with the water in here, we're not going to cause problems with the bedroom next door or with the unit below. Now, the shower we've completely removed and we're going to start all over again, but as you can see, we've actually decided to keep the old bath. The old baths are built very, very well, they're really strong, and so we'll actually renovate around it and then re-enamel it so it looks brand spanking new. Now in the master bedroom, we've just stripped it all out. So we've removed the old wardrobe and then completely stripped the ensuite, so we've got a blank canvas to start with.
Now let's meet the builder that oversees the majority of Chris's renovations, Costa Corolambus.
The cupboards that were existing were only 450 wide, which isn't wide enough to have a deep sink or to install a dishwasher. We're extending that out to 600 and running cupboards all the way across.
The builder you choose should be able to manage everything from simple kitchen bathroom refurbishment to completely overhauling whole blocks of units and adding extra levels. If you can, find a builder like Costa that gives an on-time, on-budget guarantee, but that's something not often heard of in the building game.
So a lot of people, when they're renovating bathrooms, just put tiles on tiles. What's the difference between that and going back to bare walls?
Well, look, the main problem that you've got by putting tiles on top of tiles is you're never going to get a waterproofing certificate from a professional to give you the 7-year warranty with doing it. You're better off ripping the tiles off altogether, re-screening and then re-waterproofing, which will give you that 7-year guarantee. And the last thing you want as well, once you've spent, you know, $7,000 or $10,000 doing up a bathroom, you know, 6 months or 12 months down the track, you got water issues, which is one of the main problems or the main problem to have when one's doing renovation work.
So how come you decided to keep the same bath in here?
A few reasons. The number one reason is very hard to find the same size bath. So the owner wanted to keep this bath here, so we didn't want to take the old one out and not be able to find a new one to put back in there.
The second reason is once you've taken this bath out, you need to basically redo the drainage to the unit downstairs. The difficult part with that is you need to get strata authority to do so, plus you need to get the owners to consent to allow you to actually walk into their apartment and, you know, rip out halls like this and rechange drainage, etc. So 99% of the time, it's just easier to just leave the bath in as is and just get it resprayed. From a building point of view, it's $99 for a new bath, or it's $600 to $800 to respray a bath. So, you know, we'd rather put a new bath in there. Most of the times, it just doesn't work. And if the owner wants to keep a bath, then we just leave the same one in there and get it resprayed.
So everything looks really good here, apart from the old electricity box. What are you going to do there?
Basically, what we're going to do is we're going to remove this old grey box, which is a, you know, common thing in the 1960s and 70s blocks, and replace it with a new modern box with a safety switch and then switches for every room in the apartment, which will bring it up to BCA standard. And, you know, the cost of that's only, you know, between $400 and $600, so it's very minimal cost.
In the third bedroom, you decided to have a sliding internal door rather than a normal swing door.
Just for space. Again, if we had a swinging door there, it'd make it difficult to get in and out of the bedroom. Plus, if you had that door open, whether you had it open on the inside, you'd basically have room that you lose in the bedroom. And if you had it open outside towards the hallway, it'd be difficult to go up and down the hallway. So by putting a sliding cavity door in there, we still have all that space, and it just makes it a lot easier to use that area.
When a lot of people are renovating, quite often they might keep the old doors or the old wardrobes to save a bit of dollars, but you decided to replace them?
Yeah, look, 30-year-old block again. You know, you probably had tenants in here for the whole 30 years, so when we came in here, the doors were the old brown doors. They were all basically hanging off the threads down the bottom. So, you know, for $400-odd, we basically replaced the door, new handle, new lock, modernises it a hell of a lot more. And with the wardrobes, you know, he had the old mirrored wardrobe in here before. We've changed it to the melamine doors and just all new, you know, internals, which again, just once the carpet goes down, just makes it look a hell of a lot better than the old glass doors. Everything's brand new. So yeah, whether he's moving in here or you've got a tenant moving in here, you know, they'll appreciate those little things.
So before we had this really ugly pipe here, how come you build a box around it?
Okay, well, basically this was the old toilet stack that ran through here all the way across here and then up through there and outside. The owner came and inspected it, you know, a few weeks ago, and basically said, look, he didn't like the look of having that stack running along the floor. So what we did was we built a wall up and then enclosed it where you could actually put, you know, your soap hoarders and your shampoos or whatever you might want to on here. One of the minor issues we had was basically we had already waterproof the floor. So after we basically blue boarded this up, we also needed to waterproof all this area up before putting the tiles down, so we don't have any future water problems.
Even just by tiling this balcony, it's amazing at the difference it looks. What made you choose the same tiles for here in the kitchen?
Look, we try to keep things consistent. So they're not exactly the same tiles, they're exactly the same style of tile, but inside they're obviously the indoor tile, and outside here they're an external tile, so they're non-slip. But you know, there's no point in having a grey tile inside and then a red tile outside. You just want to keep it consistent throughout. And the other thing as well, this balcony didn't drain right, so you could see we've X'd all the tiles down and created weep holes where the water's going to run down to.
So you're looking to build your own property empire. Doing it using renovations can be really tricky. So here are the five most expensive mistakes that you can make within a renovation that you need to be aware of. Number one is buying with emotion. We've all seen the property renovation shows over the last 5 to 10 years and fallen in love with them. Most people will have a renovation on their bucket list. Unfortunately, it's not about buying with the heart. It's about buying with the head and focusing on the numbers. It's essential that you make a profit out of that deal. And that means allowing for your purchase price, all the costs involved, and your profit when you go to sell. Number two is paying too much for the property. There's a saying in the real estate industry that you make your money when you buy, and that's so true. If you haven't allowed for a good purchase price at the start, then whatever you do for the renovation and whatever you sell it for is not going to make a difference. A good trick to use is to start with the end price in mind and work backwards from there. So allow for the price you can sell it for, minus all your costs and your profit, and that's what you should start with as a purchase price. Now, if you can't negotiate that purchase price on the day, then walk away, because there's another saying that says the deal of a lifetime is around the corner once a week. Number three is overcapitalization, or what we call blowing out the budget or paying too much for the renovation. Now, worst case scenario, this can be crippling. It can mean not being able to pay your suppliers, not being able to pay for your materials, and a cash flow problem that could eventually mean the bank walks in and takes the project away. Best case is you have to sell the project at a later date and you have a big hole in your bank account. Point number four is trying to do the project yourself. Now, a lot of people think they can save money by going in and doing the project on weekends. What they don't realise is this is probably a false economy, because tradies can do it much faster and much more cost efficient than you can. They'll often get a lot of savings on the materials and they'll do it much quicker than you will, which means that your loan repayments are reduced much further. So don't go to the trouble of trying to do it all yourself. A quality tradesman will save you time and money in the long run. You also need to consider where this renovation is in the market. If you're in the middle to upper tier of your renovations, prospective buyers are going to be looking for a quality of workmanship that you may not be able to provide on a DIY level. A quality tradesman will save you time and money in the long run. Number five is not renovating to the target market. Now, we've all been told, don't renovate for yourself. It's about renovating for the prospective buyer who is looking for that sort of home. Put the designer magazines away and go out into the field and ask the agents in that area, what's selling right now? What's really hot? What do people ask for? Make a list of those criteria, take them away and put them in your renovation, and that'll mean big profits on your bottom line. Now we're going to throw back to Chris at Bondi.
So here we are, 5 weeks since we started the renovation and it's finally complete. So I'm going to take a look around and see what the result is. I'll also then have a chat with the property manager and the valuer to get their opinions on how well we've done. First impressions are really important when you're renovating property, and as soon as you walk in here, everything looks purpose-built and that's the way it was supposed to be. Compare that to the DIY job that was before. So over here we've got the third bedroom with custom built-in wardrobes, and then we wander into the open-planned lounge, dining room, and obviously open-planned kitchen as well. This kitchen is almost double the size of any other unit kitchen. We've got a massive space here for a fridge-freezer. We've got a dishwasher down here, we've got the oven and hob there, and we've got this massive laundry area with its built-in washer dryer. And even better, we've made sure we're going to have no problems in the future, and we've upgraded the electricity box as well. The bathroom is one of the biggest changes around here, especially if you remember what it was like before. So now, whether you're going to have a bath or you're going to have a shower, everything is brand spanking new, and at least you're going to do it in style. When there's three of you sharing a unit and you're in the main bedroom, you want to make sure you're living in style. So at least now we've got a massive brand new wardrobe and you've got a purpose-built ensuite over here with none of those ugly pipes.
Chris Karalambos has been a property manager for over 10 years and finds and manages tenants for all of the properties that Your Empire purchases. His input is essential when deciding how to renovate a property for prospective tenants. You should never renovate for your taste. Instead, renovate to a prospective tenant's or buyer's wants and needs.
So Chris, with a property like this, what kind of tenant do you think is going to be attracted to it?
It attracts a few different types of tenants. You get the corporate couple, maybe that wants the extra bedroom for the study. It could also attract a small family. It hits a diverse market when it comes to the rental, especially the property being a three-bedder so close to the beach.
So what kind of things are those tenants trying to find in the property?
Most important thing I tend to find is in close proximity to shops, transport and obviously Bondi Beach. They want the size, and most tenants these days want something that's renovated and brand new also helps an awful lot.
So what makes this property unique?
The size of the property. Not many properties in Bondi do have the two bathrooms. It's also got the three bedrooms, which are all decent size, the good size kitchen, it's got the internal laundry. So pretty much it ticks all the boxes.
And what do you need to watch out for when you're doing a renovation like this?
The most important thing to look out for is actually not overcapitalising, but at the same time not going too cheap on the renovation. The more low maintenance that you keep a renovation, the better it is for the landlord and obviously for the tenant as well.
So how well do you think the client has done financially?
He's done very well financially.
Before purchasing the apartment, it was actually rented on a fixed term lease, and they were paying $420 a week. It was probably worth a little bit more than that, so it was a little bit under market rent. I would have thought it would be worth $520 a week based on other comparables that I've rented in the area. As a three bedroom apartment with two bathrooms, we're looking at probably around $850 to $900 a week would be very easily achievable in today's rental market. So very good gain. I think at $850 a week, it's probably at around 5.5%, hovering close to 6% at $900.
Jason Field is a professional property valuer. He researches other comparable properties recently sold and gives a completely impartial opinion on the property's worth. Using a professional valuer is almost a 100% guarantee that you never overpay for a property.
So as a valuer, what kind of things are you trying to find in the property that makes it a good risk for the bank?
Aspects such as the location, is it in a prime spot, close to amenities, good natural sunlight, is it well presented, nice quiet small block with parking, sort of the features which would be readily appeal to people in the marketplace.
So what kind of things are you trying to avoid in the property?
Anything such as a busy main road, units with poor security, major privacy issues, poor sunlight, high expenses, major problems in the building, etc.
How hard is it to find the perfect renovatable property in these blue chip suburbs?
Very difficult, Chris. And if you can find one, they're normally well sought after and keenly contested.
So the buyer paid $700,000 for the unit and then spent about $100,000 renovating it. How do you know that he's done a good job?
Look, I think in this instance, it's money well spent and the property looks absolutely beautiful. It's very difficult to overcapitalise in such a premium position such as this, and I think you'll get a better rental income as an investment property, and in better times, I think there's potential for obvious and quite strong capital growth.
How important is it to understand the demographics of who's going to live in it or to buy it?
Absolutely. Look, in property, it's who's the likely buyer's a fundamental concept of valuations for the bank. So, in terms of who's likely to live in it, who would it appeal to, fundamental to finding tenants and resale.
So what advice have you got for someone that's buying and renovating property, no matter where they do it in Australia?
Like any major decision, take your time, do a lot of homework, speak to the experts, get a valuation done, which is objective, give you peace of mind. And suggestion, get a buyer's agent who's local to the area and give you that peace of mind and do the homework for you.
Thanks for joining me on this journey of this 5-week renovation project. We started off with a pretty unloved, shabby, do-it-yourself renovated 3-bedroom unit, and we've gone back to bare walls. We've waterproofed it, and we've turned it into something brand spanking new. This renovation has cost the owner about $125 a week in extra mortgage repayments from the $100,000 renovation, but he's going to get about $400 or $500 a week in extra rental repayments, and that's positive cash flow in anyone's book. It's almost impossible to get a 5.5% to 6% rental return on a property of this value and in this location, so he's got a cracking result. Not only will the owner be getting a much better rent return from having a better tenant, but also his capital appreciation should get better and better as the confidence returns to the market. If you're thinking of renovating for profit, here's a few tips that may be of help. Try and buy in the best possible location you can, because if things do go slightly wrong, at least generally that value is still protected. Consider speaking to local real estate agents, property managers and valuers to really get a good understanding of the demographic of buyer or potential renter for your property. Make sure you don't under or over capitalise, as that's just throwing money away. Also consider using the professional services of a builder or project manager, as that will probably give you a better chance of making sure that your renovation goes on time and on budget. Thanks for joining me on this very special edition of Your Property Empire, and tune in next week for some more tips and ideas on buying property.